Hello, this is Artem Barsky, co-founder of Dateleum. In the previous video, we looked how to start analysis of RNA-seq data, and today, here we will look at the results. So this is one of our RNA-seq experiments. Let's click on it. We can see here that the mapping was pretty good. Okay, so you can see mapping is about 72% to transcriptome, which is great. There is a relatively small number of reads that are not mapped, and there are also reads which are mapped outside annotation. So here we have experiment which is mRNA-seq, so this is poly-A enriched RNA, and this is expected relatively small number. If you have a much larger number, it can mean two things. Either your mRNA selection didn't work very well, or it is possible that you have a DNA contamination in your RNA, in which case you need to use DNAs when preparing RNA. Let's look at other quality controls. So here you see the number of reads. Here are the reads of Weld adapters and Trim-Galore correctly identify them as Illumina TrueSeq adapters. You can see statistics for alignment, for the bump file, and so on. Let's look at other quality controls. So here on the left, we have base frequency plot. This shows you the frequency of each base of each position at the read. As you know, human genome is 80 rich, but the transcriptome is not. And so for this reason, you have almost the same frequency of all four bases. If you see that your RNA-seq reads are 80 rich, it means that either you have DNA contamination or you have your mRNA selection didn't work very well. There is also experiment where you are sequencing the whole transcriptome, which includes exomes. And in this case, you will also see more of A and T bases. The second quality control plot just shows the quality, average quality at each base. So in this case, it looks pretty good sequencing run. Let's look at our results on the genome browser. So you can see that we have two tracks on top. So these are reads that are mapping to the top strand, and on the bottom, the reads that are mapping to the bottom strand. The actin B gene is going from right to left, and the reads actually in the GUTP method actually map on the opposite strand, so to the top strand. And as you can see, this is a strand specific or GUTP experiment. And in this case, you see the reads only on the top strand. If you saw the reads on both strands, it would mean that the experiment is not stranded and you should analyze it with non-stranded pipeline. Let's look at another gene. So I'm going to enter PPIA. This is the gene name for another control gene, cyclophilin. And you can see that here the reads are on the bottom strand because the gene is going into different direction from left to right. Also, here you can see a pretty sharp exon structure. So there are very few reads in the introns. And that also tells us that our mRNA selection work. And you can also look outside the genes. And as you can see, we have very few reads outside the gene. And this tells us that we don't have DNA contamination. What else do we have? We also have gene expression values. And here for each gene, we have RIF-seq ID. Its coordinates and strand, as well as the number of reads and RPKMs, reads per kilobase per million mapped reads, which are assigned to this gene. Let's look at the final tab file. So these are all the files that are produced by CiteUp, and I would like to attract your attention to three of them. So RPKM isoforms, these are the number of the reads and RPKMs for each of the gene isoforms. This is the first thing that is calculated by the pipeline. Then some people are more interested in the activity of promoters rather than expression of individual isoforms. And in this case, the program would sum up the RPKM values for the isoforms that are expressed for the same promoter. And so these are RPKMs for a common TSS. And finally, if you don't care about activity of promoter and you want to know expression of all the isoforms for the genes, this is the third file, RPKM genes, which sums up the RPKM values for all isoforms of the gene. Finally, you can look at the workflow that was performed and look at all the steps that are here. Thank you, and in the next video, we will see how to do differential expression analysis using a program called DSEQ or DSEQ2. Thank you.